Now I would like to continue in English and turn to our first panelist, Mr. Henrik Otto, senior design and innovation professional. And Mr. Otto may be proud of 25 years experience in business, and he has held several senior design positions in, I should say, multi-international corporations such as Volvo Cars or AB Electrolux, both well-known brands. And in year 2008, entrepreneurs delegation from Latvia also had a chance to visit AB Electrolux, and we have references that you were the one who received them there. So
yes, correct.
So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So what I'll do is I'll kick off and tell you a little bit more in detail about myself first. And what I did is I started working as a designer about 25 years ago, and I've worked both at a consulting designer for small consulting firms, doing little plastic things, very uncomplicated. Joined Volvo Cars for my second turn in 1994 as a junior designer. Spent 10 years there, and when I left the company, I was the design director for the company. Got headhunted and moved to Stockholm to be the global head of design for Electrolux. So I've done both the actual nitty-gritty part to working with design strategies and finding ways of stimulating big groups of creative peoples and creating the space for them to do that. I'm sure everybody knows exactly the first thing that they designed and for who they did that. The first thing I designed that actually went into production, and I was really, really proud to do that, I actually designed the plastic mats that go in the driver position for a car. That was the first thing I designed. I designed the pattern on that. And I was really, really proud because it was made in millions after that. So obviously, not a very glamorous product, but still it's about the passion that you feel for what you do. And my main drivers as a person is actually obviously passion, but also that you have to continuously be curious about what it is you're doing and curious about learning new things. And then you have to have the stamina. You have to have the energy to last and continue when everybody says that it is impossible and everybody would like you to do something else. You have to continuously push forward. So I'm going to share a little bit of my experiences with you. And I think that the first thing is, and I'm sure you all done this, even though you might not know it, everybody asks themselves four subconscious questions when they see a new product. It is, do I see it? Obviously, because otherwise it doesn't exist. Do I like it? And do I want it? And do I understand it? And the two most important ones is the first one, if I see it, and the last one, do I understand it? The last one is the one that creates a relationship. And there we go. To be able to, now this is moving a little bit slower than it should. Okay, come on. There we go. To make the customers and the consumers, you heard a lot about people talking about customers in the beginning. I make a separation between customer and consumer. Because at the end of the day, you might be selling something or making something for a customer who then passes it on to somebody else. So the consumer experience is one, and the customer experience is something else. Now, to be able to make people see and understand, because the understanding is the one that makes your customer or your consumers want to come back and have a relationship with you. If they don't understand what it is you're doing, you're going to become a one-hit wonder, like somebody who does a fantastic pop song, and it's the most important and most popular one for the summer, and then nobody remembers who did it the next summer. So if we talk about relevance and a little bit about relationships at the same time, we'll get into the relationship part. You have to figure out, for who are you doing the products? If it's an innovation or if it's design, doesn't really matter. Who is the customer and who is the consumer? It could be that it's the same or it's two different things. And people or the company or yourself, are you a single product company or are you a multi-product company? What I mean by that, if you have a range of product, you also want to use the products to create some kind of relationships with the company. So you want them to be brand building. They have to have some kind of a consistent identity. So if we talk about relevance for a while, so it's either relevance for the company, if the company is you and you have an internal design department, or for the company that you're doing your services for. You have the customer, which is the person who buys the stuff from you, and you all know all of this, so I'm not going to go into depth on that. But then you have the consumer. Now, to be able to create some relevance, you have to have a little bit of a different approach between the three different ones. So, as a company, are you using design to create a long-term relationship and trust in you made by the customer and the consumer? So they would like to have a relationship with you, not seeing you as this sort of big, fuzzy company that's not untangible, but actually sees your company as an individual that has a certain set of values and opinions about things and would like to be perceived in a certain way. Then you're going to have to use the product as something which is brand building. If you're talking about the customer, well, you heard the phrase B2B earlier today. And I know it's an old phrase and it's been used to death, but it's still in some cases valid. So if you're a B2B company, then your customer is actually somebody who's going to sell whatever design or innovation or whatever product it is that you're doing on to their consumer. So you have a relationship both with the customer, but the dissatisfaction with the product comes from if you didn't do a good job for the consumer. I'll give you an example. If somebody has a big trucking company and they sell fleets of trucks, or a bus company, the customer is the person who buys the trucks or the buses from you, but the consumer is actually the driver. They might have very, very different needs and very, very different reasons for why they choose your product or are happy with that product. So you have to know them both. But I think that one of the most important things at the end of the day is, yes, you have to know the consumer. And as you probably heard before also, not only by sort of studying them. They're not lab rats. It's not sort of science. That's not what you do. What you want to do is you want to get to know them. You want to have a relationship with them. You want them to tell you what they think is good and what they think is bad, and figure out also what the underlying reasons are for why they do certain things. Why did they do that? Or why did they do this? And when you figure out those areas, that's where you find the spaces or the blank spots where you have an opportunity to create a product which is relevant for the consumer and therefore becomes relevant for the customer also. Simplify and amplify. What do I mean by that? Well, simplify in the sense of simplify for yourself. What are the good assets that I have? And then how do I amplify them? How do I pump them up and make them more visible and more driving than I've done up till now? What's your qualifiers and what's your differentiators? And the scary thing with this is that they vary. So if you end up in the comfort zone, what you think is your differentiators become hygiene factors and become qualifiers in your own industry. Unfortunately, that's very often what happens with big companies who do fantastic and great designs, and they don't see that things evolve and move on, and therefore their innovation and their fantastic designs and their fantastic insights and their fantastic content in their product become hygiene factors, qualifiers to even be on the list of somebody who's going to be allowed to sell a product to a customer or a consumer. So the differentiators are constantly moving targets. You heard Steve Keel earlier today talk a little bit about his and others also talk a little bit about their concerns about where is Apple going. Me too, in the sense that I have high regards for that company. They have been hugely innovative, but a great innovation now is not another iPhone. It's what is the equivalent of another iPhone from an innovation point of view or from a design point of view. What is the next sort of leapfrogging innovation or product design that takes things further away? And why I talk about relevance is because relevance is the only thing that defines the height of an innovation. Technical complexity? No. It's how relevant is it to me? And the more relevant it is to me and the more relevant it is to a lot of other people in solving something that we all found out being a pain point, the more height in the innovation you have. Filling it with a lot of technical content, advanced materials and all that, doesn't do a thing for you or for me as a customer if it doesn't have relevance in what it does for me and solving my problems. Everybody wants to know what the most common mistake is. I think that the most common mistake any company does when they say that they want to use design as a unique quality in their product offering is that they, number one, they think that design is taking a toaster, putting on a new outside on it, and selling it again without any new functionality or anything like that. That is not design. That is styling. That's cosmetics. It doesn't have anything to do with design because there's no insight behind that. So the most common mistake is not involving design as a capability early enough in the product development phase. Because what you want is not to design the product already in the beginning, but you want to have the sounding board and the opinions of the designer around what it is you're trying to conceptualize. You want to have them on the ride of doing the insights, doing the consumer discussions, getting to know who they're doing things with, asking all the soft questions around why this, why not that. To do the right choices already in the beginning of the product development so you don't end up in costly changes later on. How many of you in here work as designers or product developers?
None.
Oh, I'm impressed. A couple. Well, the thing that designers and product developers hate the most, you know what that is? It's when somebody who's in charge of product costs show up really late because the product became too expensive and they need to take out cost. And the only thing they are able to take out cost on is visible things. Everything that the customer experiences when they touch, feel, and handle the product, because those are the easiest to change at a late stage. But it's also the costliest changes to do from a product perception point of view, because those are the ones that actually are at the top of the line of the four questions that consumers ask themselves. Do I see it? Does it make an impact on me? If you start taking those things away, you don't have a polarizing design anymore. Then you become the fast food of your business, which might be really good if that's where you would like to be. But if you want to make a mark and if you want to build a brand, you have to be polarized. You have to be very different than the rest, but in a relevant way, than the rest of your competition is. Otherwise, your customers are going to buy and your clients are going to buy and your consumers are going to buy your stuff once. They're going to be really disappointed, and then they're going to move on. Change is inevitable. So you have to embrace it. This quote is actually a little bit longer. It is actually, change is inevitable, embrace it or perish. Disappear. Not exist anymore. And what I mean by that is, there's quite a lot of people who talk about that they know their customers and the consumers. Everybody does. I do. We did at the company where I've worked, both of the companies where I worked. Your customer is a moving, and your client is a moving, and your consumer is a moving target. If you have lead times which are 10 years of developing products, and you think that the buying age of that product is around 20s, and people of certain values and cultural opinions about themselves and so on and so forth, you're going to have to look at the 10-year-olds today. Those are the ones you're going to have to figure out. What are their references today? How are they sort of swimming in the pool of technology and neighboring products and all those different things? And why should they choose what I'm starting to work on now in 10 years' time or in 5 years' time when I can launch that onto the market? So focus on who you're going to do it for. And this is also why I'm not a great fan of these focus groups and product clinics and things like that. And the reason for that is that if you have a new concept, you're going to launch it in a couple of years onto the market, and you go and ask 10 people or 15 or 100 people what they think about this concept or this product that you are going to launch in a couple of years, you're not going to get really, really good answers. Why? Because they don't have the right frame of reference. You're asking them about something that's in the future, but with their frame of reference in everything that's societal, product, everything that sort of is around them today. So what you're then saying, that you think that everybody who's in your panel could actually see into the future. The only people I know that claim that they can see into the future are the people who forecast the weather on TV. And you're all laughing, because how often are they actually right?
Never.
Never.
So you see my point. You have to sort of put that into the context. And what you have to do instead is you're going to have to trust your intuition. And the only thing I can say, intuition gets better with experience. So the more mistakes you've done, and the more things you've done, the better your intuition becomes. It doesn't mean that you take all your experience and you use that to sort of say, well, we tried that before, so that, and we know that's not going to work. That's not intuition. That's actually being a little bit of a coward and not daring, I would say. But what you have to do is you have to take your intuition and dare to push the boundaries and say, okay, well, I'm going to take this leap of faith and I'm going to do this kind of concept based on, to my best abilities and to our best knowledge, insight around who the customer and consumer is, what I think they like and dislike, and all the research I've done on their way of acting in relation to different things that might affect what it is I'm doing, and put that into the context of a product, and then also have the difficult task of seeing to that it actually creates a relationship with them. So you're not just doing a product which is great looking, but actually makes them remember you. And I got a question for you. I don't have an answer for it, but this is, I think, is a very valid question when it comes to building design and building brand and talking about innovation. Somewhere along the line of a successful company and its development when it comes to great design and great innovation, you stop looking at what the products are and you turn into seeing that, yeah, this brand name automatically in my mind means innovation, high standards of design, great quality, and therefore, whenever I see their logotype or their, even their commercials, I immediately think that they're very creative from a design point and an innovation point. I imagine quite a few of you are thinking about Apple right now, which I think is a very valid point to do. But that's only a company that does a lot of hardware stuff. So if you think about a company like Google, Spotify, Instagram, Facebook, you name it, somewhere along the line, they go from being the entity who does something for you and sells you a product to somebody who you think is a vote of confidence. And then I think the second one is to think about how quickly do you think you can destroy that reputation? Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Henrik.
Thanks.
The question and answer session comes later when I all have spoken. Let me introduce next speaker. It is Stefan. Actually, we want to hear more about trends in Scandinavia and northern region. But I'll introduce you in Latvian. I have a calculation behind that. Why? Stefans ir viens no vadošajiem dizaina tendenču ekspertiem Skandināvijā un Ziemeļvalstīs. Un tā kā nu, mēs latvieši bieži sevi asociējam ar to, ka mēs esam diezgan tuvi Skandināvijam, dažreiz atļaujamies izvirzīt apgalvojumu, ka Latvijas dizains un gaumes izjūta ir teju tas pats, ar to pašu minimālismu piedevu, tas pats, kas Dāņiem, Skandināviem, Zviedriem. Es domāju, daži no šeit klātsošiem tam varētu arī nepiekristi, tīpaši mūsu pašu skandināvu kolēģi šeit blakus man. Bet, nu, saprotams, ka mums paneļa mērķis ir ilustrēt abas puses, gan šo biznesa perspektīvu, kā piešķirt vērtību, kā pievērst uzmanību, tāpēc varbūt pirmais runātājs pamat laiku arī veltīja tieši tam, lai jūs saprastu, ka šeit nav sacensība, kurš kaut ko gaumīgāk pasniegs vai izstāstīs, bet kā tas ietekmē jūsu attieksmi, jūsu biznesu, jūsu redzējumu. Nu, bet emocionālo un radošo daļu mums vajag tieši tikpat lielā mērā sajust un izgaršot. Un tāpēc Štefans, kurš sadarbojas ar tādiem medijiem kā TV4, arī Zviedrijas radio, arī žurnāli, tā kā Plaza un Rezidence, arī aktīvi darbojas sociālajos medijos, vada dizaina blogu tīklu un arī savu pārraidi vietnē YouTube. Nu, tā kā es pats esmu ļoti interesēts dzirdēt un ceru, ka jūs arī. Stefan, the floor is yours. You didn't understand the word, but
I heard YouTube.
Believe me, I was giving just positive comments.
I hope so. Otherwise, I'll come back.
But I was raising expectations. Now
Okay. Here's the presentation. Hi. Good morning or good afternoon, or whatever time it is now. I got up at 4 in the morning, so I'm a bit tired. But let's not talk about my tiredness. But that's why I look the way I do. I'm going to give an introduction to you. I have 20 or 30 minutes to talk about trends. Normally, I do that in an hour, so we're going to do this really, really quick. Normally, when I hold my seminars about trends, I spend about 15 or 20 minutes talking about what trends actually are. I'm not going to do that 20 minutes. I'm going to do that in 2 minutes, because trends is a very valued word. It means something, and some people say they are not trendy. And actually, a lot of people say that it's trendy to say that you're not caring about trends anymore. And why is that all of a sudden trendy to not care about trends? Well, it depends on how you label trend. What is a trend? This is one way of describing how trends work and what they are. This is not a DART chart. This is actually then a symbol of a trend is born somewhere and then spreads like rings of water. Some people talk about trends as in pyramid shapes, and you have trendsetters on the top of the pyramid, and then the rest of us are lower below, and not meaning so much, I guess. And I think they're very hierarchical, so I'd rather talk about in this way instead, but trends are born somewhere, and then they spread. For instance, this summer I started this, the beard thing. I wanted to go for the hipster look, of course, obviously. But then again, I'm middle-aged by now, and you all know that the hipster look has been around for a while, and why do I start it all of a sudden? Well, I'm not in the center anymore, because I'm middle-aged, I'm further out. But the way we are confronted with new things, and that we think are interesting, that is depending on who we are and where we are in life. And you can look at the rings of water here, and the younger you are, the closer to the birth of the trend you are normally. So when you are in your 20s, you're very interested in new things, and the older you get, then you know, other things in life is more important, kids, house and garden, whatever. The way you live is, of course, also another relevance to talk about. There's difference between houses and apartments, but then I tend to talk about the size of the city, of course. The bigger the city, the closer to the trend birth you are, and the smaller a place you live in. That doesn't mean that you are uninteresting, but you're confronted with information. When you live in a big city like Stockholm or Riga, you have tons of information. The billboards on the street, the advertisements on the buses, you have free magazines, and there's like a different, the different things in the stores. So you're confronted with newer things on a regular basis than if you live in a smaller place. So the younger you are, the bigger the city you live in, the more trend interested you are. You can also talk about sex. The more eager you are to get laid, the trendier you want to be, because you want to be invested in. Because look at me, I'm the one who has, you know, keep track of things. You should invest in me. Hence the beard. No, I'm just kidding. No, I don't have the beard to get laid. So trends are born somewhere and then they spread like rings of water. Trends are normally born in world capitals like London, Paris, Milan, and New York. London, Paris, Milan, and New York. You can talk about other important cities like Berlin and Tokyo, perhaps, but normally you tend to, you know, mention London, Paris, Milan, and New York. This is where the design weeks are. This is where the fashion weeks are. This is where the retails are and the interesting restaurants are. London, Paris, Milan, and New York. And if there's one city that's more important than anyone else, it's, of course, New York. Everything needs to get a sort of a, like a blessing from New York. So did you think that the Italian barista culture comes from Italy? No, it comes from New York. The trendy French bistro thing that all the restaurants are trying to do, does it come from France? No, it comes from New York. So everything needs a blessing from New York when it comes to our region, especially for the Nordic region. Again, I could talk about more about how this works, but I'm not going to do that. But we're going to talk about this lady. I think you all recognize her. You should. You recognize her from school. This is Empress Josephine, Napoleon's wife. I have her as an example because, again, trends are a way of getting a better life. And who defines a better life? Well, someone like Empress Josephine. When Empress Josephine introduced the empire style, having gowns and dresses with, you know, the waistline very high up and decorating your home with antiquities. That is a style or a lifestyle. And she introduced that. And then, of course, all the other ladies wanted to live that life. And this is what we call of spreading. Again, if you talk about how something is spreading the rings of water, you can also talk about the trickle-down effect. Earlier, we were looking at people in the higher classes or higher statuses, and the trend was dripping down from the higher status to the lower status. Therefore, I start with the beard later on in life. But again, I think that Henrik might get the beard later on. We'll see, we'll see. Previously, we were looking at people like royals to find inspiration of what a better life is. Today, we don't look at royalties necessarily. I'm sorry, Swedish Crown Princess Victoria. But we rather look at celebrities. Celebrities are our royalties of today. This Kim Kardashian's life we want to live. It's whatever celebrity we have. It's their life. Angelina Jolie's life. It's their life that we want to have. That is how a trend is spreading. Forecasting is extremely tricky, of course. Forecasting on about what is the next coming trend. I think everyone wants to know what's going to happen in 15 years' time. This is a slide of someone else's choice. Someone was trying to predict the future in 20 years' time, and we can absolutely already see that things are not correct. This was done then in 2010. Point number 9 there, the Middle East is becoming more secular. Not really. Look at the Islamic State, look at what's happening with Israel and Palestine. I mean, this is getting more and more. Look at what's happening in Turkey. Everything is actually the opposite of that. And what about the globalization? Do we really know that the world is getting more and more globalized? Ask DHL. Do we know that, really? We think so, and we tend to like comment on this, like this is actually how it should be. And we want to predict things on a longer run because we want to keep track of things. We want to know what happens in 20 years' time. But look at our lives. Internet happened in 15 years, Facebook in 6 years, Instagram in 1 year, and I'm sure you all have Snapchat. If you don't have Snapchat, you're out. I'm just kidding. Of course, you don't have to have Snapchat. But then again, this is things are happening so fast now. I mean, it's immensely faster than we can actually predict. So I tend to say that a lifestyle trend, which I fall back on, the lifestyle that we want to live, the ideals and the goals and what we want to be, I tend to talk about them at the maximum of 5 years' time. Maximum 5 years' time. It's difficult to foresee things in the longer term. But again, I guess most people want to. Okay, that was the introduction. And of course, these are the five trends I'm going to talk to you about. There are absolutely more trends, more than five trends, but these are the ones that are sort of like bulked up together, and then we can see some sort of like relevance between them. And let's kick off with the first one. Drama with exclamation marks. Well, 2013 and 2014 was fuck boring. Everything was boring. All the music on the radio sounded like Swedish House Mafia. All the movies looked the same. All the clothes in the fashion store looked the same. And nothing happened in the interior design scene whatsoever. I'm sorry. But then again, this leads to a reaction that we're looking for, that something like actually speaks to us. It's a reaction to the minimalistic lifestyle that we had. All the whiteness, the white room with the white TV bench, the white sofa with the orange pillow. Everything was white, clean, and minimalistic. And now we want a reaction to that. And this is, of course, together with storytelling. Our apartments, the way we live, is a part of our storytelling. I want to talk to you about what is the life of Stefan. Who am I? Well, I talk to you about the way I live, and then I blah, 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 blah. Storytelling, storytelling, storytelling. So interior-wise, this is the reference. Next slide is, of course, the most important slide for 2015. And then I'm getting your attention, because I'm going to wait a bit. All the trends are from London, Paris, Milan, and New York. Next slide is, of course, from Paris. It's a designer who lives there, an enfant terrible. I don't know if you met him, Henrik, but you're going to find out who it is very soon. Yes, he's trying to live the dramatic life, like on a stage. And this is the inspiration for 2015. Everyone should get a life-size giraffe across their apartment. This is drama. This is getting a different level of so storytelling, of course. Who lives here? Of course, Ora Ito lives here, and he's different, he's strange, he stands out, he's creative. And this is the opposite to the boring, modernistic life that we've had for a long, long time. This is interesting. This is drama. Who wants to be normal? Normal is a bad word today. Who wants to be normal? No one wants to be normal. And we see absolutely how the fashion scene is now changing to get more and more talkative. People are talking to us with the fashion scene. We're actually revolting against the big brand names. Who is interested in Prada in 2015? No one is. Because Prada is boring, normal. Everyone can get that nowadays. It's more important in 2015 to get a t-shirt that says Homies on it rather than Hermes. So we're revolting against those demanding brands that we felt were like giving rules of how to live. The heels of the high heel shoes should be exactly 7 centimeters, blah, 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 whatever it should be. So now we're actually looking towards the street to find inspiration, drama again. And no, I don't think that we're going to find a lot of elk horn chairs in our lives, but we're going to look at this for inspiration. And you all look at this going like, oh, of course you want that Narasaros chair. Everyone wants that. Or we try to want it anyway, because we want something that stands out, that's different. Which looks at looking for brands that are courageous, that do different things. This is also drama, the people and the brands that stand out, that don't just fall into, you know, what everyone else is doing. And everything does not necessarily have to be pretty. I mean, the skin shape stools, I think they're pretty ugly. I don't know what you think. But we look at these things that are going like, oh yeah, but at least it's interesting. At least it stands out. So this is what we're looking for. I need to talk about food, because food is the only thing that's interesting us in 2014 and 2015. We spent enormous amount of time talking and eating food. We talk and talk and talk about food. And this is the cover of an architectural magazine. And I think it's interesting that like, an architecture magazine has a pile of fruits on the cover. I mean, it's not a building as normally it should be. It's a pile of fruit. And this is so interesting that the only thing that we talk about is food. In Sweden today, with our national TV and everything, we have 70 food shows per week. 70 food shows per week. What the fuck? And we talk about food, we get interested in food. And this is sort of like that get our pulse to sort of like rush a bit. We go like, food, yeah, lunchtime. And we're moving from fine dining to fun dining. it should be like engaging and fun to eat, like in this case with the finger food, I guess. And this is also because this is also when the food trucks are coming into our lives. I don't know how, you know, if you have food trucks in Riga. I guess you have, because all the major cities in Europe have food trucks. Last year in Stockholm we had 20 food trucks. This year we have 70 food trucks. So it's like exploding. And you know the deal with the food truck. It's supposed to be secret. It's moving around. And you see on Facebook, okay, the food truck is on this corner of that street, on that street. You go there, you buy a taco, almost always tacos. You take a picture and post it on Instagram. That's how you do it. That's what it's for. It's socializing. It's talking. It's drama. It's interesting. That's what our life is all about. And I think that we're going to see a whole new creative class that's working with food. There's a new title that could call yourself a food entrepreneur. And talking about how you serve food, how you sell food, how you package food. Food, food, food. That's the main new creative industry. Absolutely. Now, I need to move on with my five trends. So we talked about drama. The second trend is nursery. It's totally related to drama, but drama is about blackness, the darkness, and you look at the colors, it's all very dark. Nursery is much more pastel-y, nicer, sweeter. Drama has the sex in it. I'm not talking about sex. We're leaving that out for now. But nursery, it's much, much kinder, candy references, etc. And if you look at this picture, this is a picture that a French brand has done, and of course they want to sell expensive perfume with this picture, and they do it with balloons. And this girl is sending images to us and signals to us. She would have sent different signals to us if she was standing in a bar with a cocktail glass. So now we're referring to the cuteness, the sweetness. And of course, the cute colors are here. And Jeff Koons and the balloon animals. We need to talk about Jeff Koons. I'm sorry. In Stockholm at the Modern Museum of Art, we have a huge exhibition, but that's not why. Because Jeff Koons is on everyone's lip this year. When a person like Karl Lagerfeld is doing a new collection with Chanel, he's inviting Jeff Koons. When H&M, well, Swedish brand, of course, when H&M is inviting someone to do a new collection, which is limited only for New York, who do they invite? Jeff Koons. And it's the cuteness, the balloon animals. Of course, they're sending signals about the cuteness and everything. So yes. And of course, colors, colors, colors. We don't look for one color, but many colors at the same time. Plenty and plenty and plenty of colors all over. And it's, of course, here we can talk about the color of the year. Personally, I hate pink, but it's one of the main colors of the year. I'm sorry. Radiant Orchid. It's a brand or a company in America that's called Pantone who's announcing the color of the year. Is it relevant? Absolutely not. Or is it? Is it? Well, of course, they do the they do their investigation really, really statistically. Pantone is interviewing a lot of design companies and designers and asking, what colors are you going to use? What colors are you going to use? What colors are you going to use? And they see that the color that's coming back is the color that's going to be the color of the year. And the criticism from us in Europe is, of course, well, the color scheme is a bit much Miami. That's what we say. But when brands like Itala or Rosenthal are sitting down and going through like, next year's color, we should do something maybe... I've heard about that Radiant Orchid. Maybe we should do something with that Radiant Orchid. So you're absolutely going to find a lot of colors in stores that are in these tones. Absolutely. Regarding if it's relevant for us or not. But it's going to come out anyway. And of course, we're going to see colors in furniture as well. Hopefully. Everything is very, very gray right now in the furniture industry. But I hope we're going to see more colors. We're moving on. Talisman is a trend that's very much inspired from the North African region. And we see the color tones are earthy. And we see a lot of tiles and symmetrical patterns. And in North Africa, you have a traditional textile or fabric technique that you call ikat. I-K-A-T. It's sort of like in Southeast Asia, you have batik, and in North Africa, you have ikat. And these sort of like patterns are everywhere right now. They're everywhere, on textiles, on porcelain, on wallpaper, very symmetrical and very much inspired from that region. And we see how now brands are moving to that region to find inspiration for the sandiness, the earthy tones, and also the symmetrical patterns all over. Symmetrical patterns, North African patterns, all over. And we can talk about stones. Stones are everywhere in interior design, not just plain stones, but also marble. Marble, marble, marble. Everywhere there are marbles. And those of you who are planning to do a kitchen, you're all dreaming about having a marble counter. Everyone is dreaming of having a marble counter. But as soon as we in the Scandinavian Nordic region hear that it stains, we go like, okay, not this time. Because we don't like stains on our marble. In Italy, they do like the stained marble, but we don't. So we dream about marble. So those of you who are in product planning, yes, of course you can do something in marble, but in this region, we're going to go like, yeah, well, if it stains, yeah, I'm not so sure. And of course, we need to talk about brass and copper. I'm so tired of brass and copper. I don't know if you are, but I'm so sick of it. I've seen it to like here by now. But it's going to stay. It's one of those like metal things that are going to stay for another year, at least another year. I'm really, really bored of it. But yes, another go with it. Structure is a trend that contains three things. We're very interested in the construction of things, how things are built. The second thing is that we're interested in the structure of the surfaces. So we're going to have structure on the surfaces of things. And the third part is we need structure in our lives. All of a sudden, there's a whole new career for those of you who are planning to go to New York. You can become a bookshelf stylist. It can be someone actually like, you liked that, didn't you? Yeah, Henrik liked that. I'm going to book him one. Because you can get a bookshelf stylist, sort of like that color, it's, you know, sorted by colors or only by Nobel Prize winners. Yeah, right. Or something the way you want it. They can have a bookshelf stylist that comes in and organizes your life. So I think that also says something about the richness of having organization around us. But then again, let's talk about the first part is, of course, structure. Everything is looking like this, very straight line, symmetrical. And this guy is then working on the structure. And here again, I talk about the cleanliness. How do we want to clean the things in our lives? And there is a huge movement right now in our part of the world. And that's an anti-consumerism right now. Again, the cleaning out of things. We think that we have too many things. We have a huge, huge movement about anti-consumption. Stuffocation is a movement from England, but there could be other things. And we're heading towards Christmas. And what do you wish for Christmas? Really? Really? Nothing. I mean, my dad called me the other day. He's like, Stefan, what do you want for Christmas? What should I get you for Christmas? And I go like, a book? I mean, the way we live today is that we can buy everything. And we have everything within reach, so we don't need anything. Why do we need another H&M? Why do we need another store that has everything that everyone else has? This is also part of a big, big movement that we have around us right now. And a big movement also in the Western world right now is talking about how do we want our cities to look like. We have a strange situation today when it's cheaper to buy new than to repair things. Is this the way we want to live? If my TV breaks down, it's cheaper to go buy a new one by one of the German chain stores than to repair it. And what if I am that good guy who finds a 50s lamp on like a website and I buy it? It's vintage and it's secondhand and I'm a good guy. It's sustainable. And then it's like broken a bit. Where do I go to fix it? Where do I go to fix it? Do I only want my cities to have new commercial stores like MediaMarkt, H&M and whatever we have, the chain stores? This is a big, big movement in the Western world today, right now. Again, let's talk about the superficial and lighter things. This is, again, the way we're going to have the aesthetically in our homes, in our lives. Everything is getting like very symmetrical, very lined, very straight lines and symmetrical. And we can talk about the surfaces of things. Again, surfaces, surfaces, surfaces. And we're moving on to the last trend, which I call Forest 2.0. And it is so that we're actually moving towards a new sustainable trend. And then you go, again? Yes. Every 10 years, we have a peak of a sustainable issue. It's now almost 10 years ago that Al Gore came out with his movie, An Unconventional Truth. It came out in 2006. So we're heading towards a new trend peak where we actually focus on sustainable issues. And every peak has its own focuses. So 2006 with the Al Gore movement was the global warming thing. In 95, 96, we talked about the ozone layer in Australia and the freons in the kitchens. And yeah. And then in 85, we talk about how the environment issue got politicalized. They had parties in Germany and parties in Sweden and other Scandinavian countries. So every 10 years, it's peaking and has different focuses. So what's the focus going to be next year? Well, we don't know. But I think it's going to be a lot about consumerism. A lot and lot about consumerism. We don't want to buy more things. That's something in common that we have. What do we want to get for Christmas? Nothing. A book. That's again, that's something that I was referring to. No one wants it. What are you going to buy? I don't want to buy anything. Anyway, let's go back to the lighter object. So Forest 2.0, except for the sustainable issues, of course, looking to for inspiration in the woods and the forests. Inspiration, so if you are a designer, apparently only two of you in this audience are designers, but the rest of you, if you want to find inspiration, you need to go out in the woods and look at, you know, if I want to make a new set of cutleries, what should they look like? Of course, they should look like something in nature. I don't know if it's good looking again, but again, this is inspiration. This is what we talk about. We talk about wild grown flowers. There's of course an organization in America that's actually announcing what sort of flower is the flower of the year. And now we have the wild grown flower, the wild grownness. Who wants like stiff superficial flowers? Want to have flowers that look like they come from nature. We're looking for inspiration. We take in inspiration from nature, and we're decorating with nature a lot on that. And all the big design department stores that I go to obviously have a growing section, a plant section. We want to grow our own things. There's a huge major trend about planting your own seeds, growing your own vegetables. Of course, the urban gardening is part of this. Of course, the whole scene with that, growing things in the city is part of that, because we want to grow our own vegetables and find the nutritious food. Again, food is a key for all the trends. And this is what all the major design stores look like. Everyone has a plot and pan section. Everyone is interested in buying seeds from like an old flower and trying to do something new with that. And interior-wise, we're decorating with large, large green plants, because we think that this is going to give us a better life. Everyone's looking for a better life. Last picture, again, we're rounding off with some food talk again. Of course, we're going to eat greener, especially within this trend. The vegetarian lifestyle is getting bigger and bigger. But the interesting thing is, of course, that you don't have to be a full time vegetarian today. You can be vegetarianish. Meaning, of course, you're cutting down on meat. Meaning, of course, you can then do the meatless Monday thing, but eat a lot of vegetables. Or you can be like a full-fledged vegetarian during the weekdays, but on the weekend, have egg and bacon. That's fine. That's vegetarianish. Totally all right. I heard also, I've checked out, that Vincent is also one of the trendiest restaurants in Riga, is serving slow food. And of course, that's also part of this. So I'm going to try it out, see if I have time to do that. Summing up, five trends. Of course, there are more trends. Of course, there are. But I'm trying to bulk it up together like this. I talked about drama. We want something dramatic, something that stands out, a bit dangerous. Nursery is also dramatic, but much, much sweeter. Pastels and niceness. Talisman is inspiration from North Africa. Structure is about structuring your life and the symmetrical lines that we have in the aesthetic world as well. Last, I also talked about Forest 2.0, which is about the new environmental and sustainable trends we take in nature. If you want to limit down these five trends into two segments, of course, you can bundle up the drama and nursery together, because that's about storytelling, taking space, talking about who you are. And then you can bundle up Talisman together with Forest 2.0, because Talisman 2.0 is about craftsness, the darker tones, the woodiness, the terracotta, and the quieter life, the homely life, the good life, if you want to do that. So these are the five major scenes that I see that are coming up. Don't forget, you don't win a prize by trying to be the trendiest person in the world. There's no one knocking on your door if you're saying at the end of the week, going like, oh yeah, congratulations, Henrik, you were the trendiest person this week. No one is doing that, unfortunately. The most important thing that you should do with trends is trying to correlate with trends and find your own taste. What do you like? That's the most important thing. But trends should also be not a rule, but rather inspiration. And with this, I say thank you.
Thank you.
No more talks. Questions after.
Thank you, Stefan. Watching you, I understood that you are most properly dressed for design panel discussion, and I also not only because of beard, but I do understand also that I'm not fitting in this panel from my outfit at all. So this is my professional duty. But as we promised, that we'll be having different perspectives, not only business perspective, but creative part, and I think your presentation was really captivating. Now we will switch to Latvian language and to our locals, local heroes. Kā nākošo pastāstīt par savu pieredzi, es ilgi domāju, kā pieteikt Aldi Circeni, vai kā arhitektu, vai kā Rīgas krēslu fabrikas valdes priekšsēdētāju, kur, piemēram, mēs patiešām lepojāmies arī aģentūrā, kad viņa izstrādāts ķeblītis Blūm ieguva starptautisko prestižo balvu, tādā Red Dot Award Product Design. Nu, un jāatzīst, ka Aldis arī ir vaininieks pie tā, ka daudzi publiski redzami objekti, ieskaitot lielās viesnīcas, arī ar savu izvēli, ne tikai ar Latvijas ražojumiem, bet bieži vien ar ārzemēs izvēlētu produkciju, ir tieši pakļauti Alda Gaumei, savu laiku kā arhitektu biroja vadītājam. Nu, tas, protams, arī turpinās, bet nu, vislabāk viņš pats jums par to pastāstīs. Lūdzu, Aldi.
Stefan, it may be interesting for you that Riga is being proclaimed as a capital city for the hipsters.
Oh, really?
Yeah, by Daily Telegraph, by the way. Yeah. They know something about hipsters.
I'll check out the beards. I'll check out the beards.
Sure. There's a certain street in Riga, you know, being the major in the world. So, tātad, labdien, visiem. Tātad, uzlūkums man jau pieteica, Aldis Circeņš esmu. Tātad, arhitekts, pēc izglītības dizainers, pēc pārliecības un dzīves, teiksim, aicinājumu. Šobrīd pārstāvu un asociēju sevi ar šiem četriem zīmoliem, jaunākais no kuriem ir vissarkanākais. Tātad, pavisam nesen transformējām iepriekšējo zīmolu, kas saucās Kopa, par Mobileum. Rīgas krēsla fabrika ir 15 gadus vecs, savukārt Rīga Chair ir kā radīta tirzniecības zīme Rīgas krēsla fabrikas paspārnē, un dizaina katalogs, ja jūs ieklabināsiet meklētājā, tad atradīsiet interesantu datu bāzi, kur visiem smelties idejas par produktiem, par trendiem un tam līdzīgām lietām. Tas, par ko es gribēju runāt, es neesmu projektējis ne lidmašīnas, ne kafijas dzirnaviņas, tāpēc par to es neko nezinu un nestāstīšu. Tas, par ko es varu pastāstīt, ir krēsls, ko es personīgi uzskatu par dizaina karali. Kādēļ? Pirms tam daži interesanti fakti. Dažus no tiem varbūt zinat, bet iespējams, ka nē. Tad vecākais zināmais krēsls, dokumentētais, ir atrasts Ēģiptē 3000 gadu pirms mūsu ēras. Bet savukārt plašu izglītību cilvēku vai, teiksim, sabiedrībā un cilvēku mītnē viņš ieguva 16. Gadsimtā tikai kopā ar renesanses ideju izplatību. Pirms tam cilvēks sēdēja, kur nu pagadās. Un tad vakar bija filmas, tad citu par sāk par vikingiem, par Ragnāru, kurš aizkuģoja līdz Amerikai un kur rāda, kur cilvēki pirms 1000 gadiem sēž milzīgos krēslos, kas manī izraisīja tad maz neizpratni. Tad interesants fakts ir, ka krēsla jēdziens pēc būtības ir atvasināts no itāļu vārdu katedra. Burtiski nozīmē sēdēt lejā. Savukārt katedrāli ir tieši atvasinājums no krēsla jēdziena, ar ko savulaik saprat bīskapa sēdekli. Tāpat laikā Bībelē krēsls nav minēts ne reizi. Dīvaini, vai ne? Man likās, ka tur viss ir minēts. Savukārt Tomas Edisons izgudroja elektrisko krēslu tik sen, lai demonstrētu mainstrāvas bīstamību. Viņam nebija nekādas likta nodoma. Savukārt visi zina, visi zina un visi par to runā, ka tad cilvēks trešdaļu dzīves pavada guļot, bet savukārt reti, kad min, ka otru trešdaļu viņš pavada sēžot. Un lūk, tas arī ir savā ziņā pierādījums manam pieņēmumam, ka krēsls tieši ir dizaina karalis. Nu, protams, gult arī. Man bieži jautā, runājot par motivāciju, kāpēc es un mani uzņēmumi pirms gadiem 4-5 ar pilnu spāru iesaistījās krēslu nu, projektēšanā un ražošanā, kādēļ tas tiek darīts un kādēļ tas ir jādara pasaule pilna krēsliem, katru gadu saražot uz 120 miljonus krēslu visā pasaulē, un kam gan ir vajadzīgi vēl kaut kādu jaunu radījumu. Un tādēļ jautājums ir, kur tad tas izaicinājums slēpjās. Un šeit man gribētos drusciņi atgriezties tādā, atskatīties atpakaļ. Un vēstīt, ka viens vietas vīrs, arhitekts, Ludvigs Mies van der Rohe, kur tie, kas interesējās par arhitektūru un dizainu, noteikti ir dzirdējuši šādu cilvēku, savā laikā teica, un tas bija diezgan sen, man šķiet, ka nu, 30. Gados pagājušā gadsimtā, ka krēsls ir ļoti sarežģīta konstrukcija, ka dažkārt ir vienkāršāk uzbūvēt debesu skrāpi nekā labu krēslu. Un viņš zināja, ko runā, jo ap to laiku viņš jau bija diezgan daudz debesu skrāpes uzbūvējis. Tāpat laikā, piemēram, šīs krēslas, kur jūs redzat, kurš ir absolūta dizaina ikona un arī kļuvis par arhetipu un ārkārtīgi plaši izmantotu krēslu bija tad Mies radīts priekš Berlīnas, priekš Barcelonas vispasaules izstādes 39. Gadā Vācijas paviljonam. Kopš tā laika jūs droši vien šķirstīsiet arhitektūras grāmatas, redzēsiet viņu bezgalīgi daudz, ļoti daudzos interjeros. Lai cik tas dīvaini nebūtu, bet varbūt likumsakarīgi, bet redzamākos šos te krēslu dizaina paraugus ir radījuši tieši arhitekti. Viens no viņiem Marcels Brojers, kurš sāka attīstīt 20. Gados liekto cauruļu teikt, estētiku un nonāca pie gaumīgu risinājumu. Gerrits Ritvelds, šis krēsls dizainēts 1917. Gadā. Grūti noticēt, vai ne? Franks Lloyds Wrights, ārkārtīgi ikoniska persona Amerikas savienoto valstu, protams, arī visas pasaules kontekstā kā arhitekts, kurš visiem saviem objektiem radīja arī mēbeļu sērijas. Alvars Aalto, tepat kaimiņš, ja tā var izteikties, slavenākais, es gribētu teikt, somu arhitekts, kurš citas starpā 30. Gados radīja pats savu liekt līmēto saplākšņu zīmolu, liekt līmēto saplākšņu mēbeļu zīmolu Artek, kurš darbojas vēl šobaldien. Un kas ir pats interesantākais, es to atradu kādā dizaina gadgrāmatā, kur bija minēts, ka 20. Gados Alvars Aalto apmeklē Rīgu ar mērķi, izpētīt liekt līmētā saplākšņa ražošanas tradīcijas. To, kā vēlāk izrādījās, nezinu pats Somi. Tātad iepriekš minētais Mies van der Rohe, droši vien esat pamanījuši ļoti daudz līdzīgu krēslu pasaulē, bet tātad šādas konstrukcijas garīgais tēvs ir tieši viņš. Slavenais Le Corbusier, ar savu LC6 guļam krēslu. Agrie 30. Tie bija. Nu, Werners Pantons, tātad dāņu dizaineris, kurš priekš, man šķiet, 61. Gada, kad šis krēsls tika radīts, principā revolucionarizēja visu mēbeļu ražošanu, jo pēc viņa ļoti daudz arhitektu un dizaineru pievērsās tieši plastmasas industrijai un, un mēbeļu ražošanai no plastmasas. Arne Jakobsens, vēl viens dānis, kurš viens no maniem absolūtiem guru un, un favorītiem dizaina jomā, tad ir radījis veselu sēriju ar ļoti skulpturālām mēbelēm, kas viss ir emocionāli ārkārtīgi iedarbīgs. Lūk. Tad viss tas, ko jūs redzējāt, ir dizains, kas ir radīts pēdējā gadsimta laikā, bet joprojām ir dzīvs un ļoti aktuāls. Un visticamāk, ka, lai kā mainītos, teiksim, tendences, par kurām minēja Stefans, šīs dizaina ikonas tik un tā atradīs vietu arī, teiksim, starp vai šo tendenču kontekstā turpmāk. Un atbildi, kādēļ tas notiek, ir ļoti spēcīgā emocionālā iedarbība. Un pēc būtības tas, par ko šodien pauž nu, dizaina teorētiķi un, un praktiķi, ka ar dizaina jēdzienu mēs vairs sen nesaprotam tikai un vienīgi preces vai priekšmeta ārējo izskatu veidolu un, teiksim, viņa utilitāro nozīme, bet pēc būtības mēs priekšmetus un preces un, un arī pakalpojumus un parādības kā tādas uztveram pēc iedarbības veida uz mūsu, ja tā var teikt, zemapziņu. Un, un tā ir ārkārtīgi tātad precīza atziņa arī no iepriekšējo runātāju puses, ka, ka galvenais šobrīd pēc kā patērētājs un, un lietotājs tiecās ir, ir paralēli produktam iegūt arī stāstu, stāstu, par kuru daļu pats lietotājs pēc tam var arī kļūt. Ir tāds holandiešu uzņēmums, dizaina uzņēmums MUI, kas rakstās ar 3 O. Un holandiešu valodā nozīmē tādu, kā izsaucienu, o, tas ir labs, vai ne? Un viņi šajā, viņi diezgan spēcīgi seko līdzi arī dizaina tradīcijām un arī paši ir šo tradīciju radītāju noteicēju, nu tā kā tāda trendsetter lielā mērā. Un tikai lai pasvītrotu to savu tēzi par, par emocionālo iedarbību uz, uz zemapziņu produktu radīšanas procesā vai, vai jau radītiem produktiem, šis ir piemērs nav gan ļoti svaigs, ir apmēram gadi varbūt 6 vai 8, tad viens no viņu produktiem, varbūt jūs varat nojaust, tas ir principā degošs krēsls. Viņi atrada veidu, kā degošu krēslu pārdot plašai publikai. Un tas izskatījās šādi. Tad gatavs, pēc būtības gatavs krēsls, koka krēsls, diezgan sarežģīts pēc savas konstrukcijas grēbs, kur cilvēki diezgan lielu daudz pūļu ieguldījuši. Koka detaļa radīšanā tiek nodedzināts pēc būtības. Lai pēc tam pārkrāsojot un polstrējot, viņu atkal padarīt par lietojumu. Savā ziņā protests pret, pret visu to minimālisma ēru, kas savā laikā tātad 90. Gados ļoti strauji ienāca dizaina pasaulē un kādus gadus 10-15 tur varbūt arī valdīja. Savukārt ļoti spilgti pasvītrojoši, teiksim, to, ka, ka arī ar tādu utilitāru lietu kā krēsls var ļoti labi iedarboties uz, teiksim, uz patērētāju ļoti emocionālā līmenī. Šeit, ja es būtu uzdūries attēlam, tur par to degunredzu krēslu, varbūt, kas ar viņu būtu iekļaus. Mazliet varbūt par mūsu pašu pieredzi, kā mēs, kā, kā uzņēmums, saprotam šo te emocionālo saikni ar pasūtītāju un mazliet arī, teiksim, nu, stāstīšanu, kas tiek produktos savā ziņā nu, iekļauts. Viens no mūsu nu, ja tā var teikt, lepnumiem ko sauc par mazulīti Rū, kuram mūsuprāt ir piemīta vis nu, izteiktākā emocionāla iedarbība uz lietotāju, tā skaitā, bet arī uz vērotāju, jo lietotāji ir maz bērni, bet vērotāji ir pieauguši cilvēki. Tur ir kaut kas, nu, nav gluži dedzināts, vai ne, bet tajā ēnā tur kaut kas no Hitchcocka, vai ne, ir nolasāms.
Bet, zīvnieks tas ir, tas nav zirdziņš.
Tas radīšanas procesā īstenībā bija, protams, vienmēr ir milzīga problēma izdomāt vārdus, nu, krēsliem vienalga, vai krēsliem galdiem, vai skapjiem, vai arī gultām, es zinu, Jūris to zina, tas ir ļoti, ļoti grūti. Un tādēļ, grozot visu šo, protams, ka viņš sāks dizainēt kā šūpuļu zirdziņš, jo kas gan vēl var būt kaut kas, kas šūpojās priekš bērnu. Ne? Bet tas ļoti stereotipisks piegājiens, un tad, kad tās aprises jau bija apmēram gatavs, un pirmie prototipi bija gatavi, es viņu sāku grozīt visādos veidos, un es atklāju, ka viņš katrā rakursā izskatās mazliet savādāk, un kaut ko citu atgādina. Un pēkšņi, skatoties tā mazliet slīp no aizmugures, man tas kaut kādā veidā asociējās ar ķengurēnu Rūno Vinī Pūk, vai ne? Un tādēļ viņam automātiski uzreiz šis pielipa šis vārdiņš. Savukārt, kā izrādījās vēlāk, tad bērni sāka ar to lietu nodarboties. Tad bija, mums bija suns, mums bija aita, nu, bija arī zirdziņš, protams. Bez ķengura bija... Jā, kādam tā izstījās pēc žirafas. Tad mēs sākam nodot ruku, kaklis ir pagaroji.
Aldi, man jālūdz ir iedot to vārdu.
Jā, jā. Tad pavisam īsi skrienot pāri, tad rinda ar produktiem, kas viens pēc otra ir tapuši samērā īsā laikā. Un visi kaut kādā mērā, vismaz mēs ar to mēģinam atbildēt uz jautājumu, kādā veidā mēs meklējam savu ceļu tajā milzīgajā produktu, konkrēti krēslu jūrā, un tas, ar ko mēs gribam atšķirties no citiem konkurentiem. Tas ir, varbūt, tāds mazliet uzsitiens pa plecu, par ko Stefans ies, ka neviens nenāk, neklāvē pie durīm un nesaka, ka tu esi baigi labais, bet tomēr ir iespējas arī kaut ko tādu izjust. Nu, lūk, tad paldies, ka uzklausījāt.
Paldies.
Jā. Ak jā, un tad, ja kāds bija varbūt augšā zālē, tad tie krēsli arī ir mūsēji. Paldies. Lā, un vēl pēdējos. Un vēl arī Nacionālā bibliotekā Ziedoņa zālē. Tā.
Paldies, Aldi. Es varu jūs drusku varbūt pabrīdināt, ka mēs drusciņu pārkāpsim, mēs sāksim ēst mūsu maltīti drusciņu vēlāk nekā tieši divos, jo mums ir vēl divi runātāji. Īpatnēji ir tieši arhitektu īpatsvars tajos trendseteros, jeb cilvēkos, kas nosaka modi, arī mūsu mazajā Latvijas mērogā, kaut arī lielā moda un tendences tiek noteikts Ņujorkā, kā teica Stefans, bet arī mūsu nākamā runātāja Elīna Dobele ir pēc izglītības arhitekte, bet ko viņa dara, viņa jums pastāstīs pati, lūdzu Elīna.
Uzdien. Man sauc Elīna Dobele, un es esmu arhitekte. Un šie ir pirmie zābaki, kas tapa pēc mana dizaina. Un, lai gan tā iecera bija faktiski pareiza, tie bija iecerēti kā viegli auduma zābaki sievietēm, ko nēsāt vasarā. Tomēr tas dizaina funkcionālais risinājums bija absolūti nepareizs. Viņi faktiski ļoti stipri cilājas papēdī, tādējādi padarot to iešanu ļoti apgrūtinātu. Un tomēr ir pagājuši 5 gadi, un dekoratīvās mākslas un dizaina muzejs ir iegādājies manus apavus saviem fondiem. Šī gada pavasarī es tiku 15 tūkstoši dizaineru, visu pasaules dizaineru konkurencē, izraudzīta kā viena no 100, lai piedalītos tādā oriģinālā jauno dizaineru pilota projektā Itālijā. Un prestižais wallpaper dzīves stila žurnāls tikko ir pārpublicējis tā kā savu ceļvedi par Rīgu, kur ir iekļāvusi manu veikalu un ateljē kā vienu no vietām, kur obligāti apmeklēt esot Rīgā. Bet pats galvenais ir tas, ka mūziķi un citas zvaigznes manos apavos jūtas ļoti ērti. Šo fotogrāfiju es uzņēmu, kad es ceļoju pa Karību jūru, pa Karību jūras salām, un lai gan šķiet, ka laiks ir rāms un mierīgs, tomēr uznākot vētrai šīs te švakās zvejnieku būdiņas var vienā mirklī tikt nopūstas. Un līdz ar to, ka faktiski pateicoties tiem pāļu pamatiem, kuri dziļi stiepjas jūras dzelmē, gultnē, tās ir iespējams ļoti ātri atkal uzbūvēt atpakaļ. Un kā arhitekte, es zinu, ka pamati ir viena no svarīgākajām ēkas konstrukcijām. Šis ir Pekinas olimpiskais stadions, kurš faktiski pulcēja 91 tūkstoti apmeklētāju 2008. gadā. Un viņš ir zināms tātā ar nosaukumu Putna līgzda. Un kad es skatos uz šo fantastisko arhitektūru, es vienmēr domāju par to, vai tā apakšzemes arhitektūra, tie pamati, vai viņi arī varētu būt tikpat vizuāli iespaidīgi. Un šī ir līgzda, ko būvēja mans tētis savai ģimenei, liekot pamata blokus pats savām rokām, vienu virs otra. Un tajā brīdī, kad es nolēmu kļūt par arhitekti, es zināju, ka es kādu dienu arī kaut ko savām rokām noteikti uzbūvēšu. Šī ir mana roka. Un tas roku darba process ir ļoti būtisks, un to var noteikti redzēt manā apavu dizainā. Aplūkojiet šo kurpi. Tās pazola ir izgriezta no lielām, milzīgām ādas loksnēm. Puse no kurpes ārējās kantes ir nošūta ar roku, otra puse ir līmēta. Un šī te ārējā šuve nodala šīs te divas daļas, tā kā veidojot tādu askētisku ģeometriju. Strādājot, man ļoti patīk sadarboties ar līdzīgi domājošiem dizaineriem vai amatniekiem. Šī zābaka stulms tika austs no trīs dažādiem diegiem. Lins, kurš panāca to iecerēto rakstu, vilna, kura savukārt nodrošināja vēlamo siltumu, un kašmirs, lai panāktu to taustēji patīkamo vizuālo pūkainumu efektu. Uzņēmums ar Stela jau gadiem tā kā kopī rokausto audumu tradīcijas un attīsta tās tādā mūsdienīgā gultnē. Šis ir neliels piemērs, kā dažreiz notiek ar to dizaina ideju rašanos un burtiski pirms nedēļas šķirstot kādu no saviem iemīļotajiem arhitektūras blogiem, es ieraudzīju šo ēku. Tā ir ekonomikas un biznesa fakultātes ēka, kas tikko ir pabeigta Čīlē, Un man burtiski te pašā brīdī radās tā sajūta, bet baigi interesanti būtu pamēģināt pārnest šo te uzzirdināto logu un balkonu ideju uz ādas laukuma tādā pavisam tiešā veidā. Un šādos brīžos ļoti svarīgi ir vai nu kaut ko uzskicēt vai tiešām ātri realizēt šo te mazo paraudziņu. Un tas ir tagad tas, pie kā es tālāk strādāju. Bet šādi spēlējoties, protams, atklājas tas, ka tā kurpe katra no viņām tomēr jau arī risina kādu funkcionālu problēmu. Un šī kurpe tapa, domājot par vīriešiem un par to, ka viņiem nepatīk ne šņorēt kurpes, ne rāvēslēdzēji. Un gribējās radīt kaut ko, kas nav loafer tipā kurpe, bet kas būtu gan nesājams ar klasisku uzvalku, gan arī vienlaicīgi pie ikdienas apģērba. Pavisam askētiska kurpe ir tikai ar vienu centrālo ārējo šuvi, un šīta gumija palīdz kājai gan iekļūt iekšā, bet viņa pietiekam stingri arī tur viņa, teiksim, uz kājas, lai būtu ērti staigāt. Lūk, un tad es vēlos ar jums dalīties pāris atziņās no šī, teiksim, pēdējā laika atziņās. Jā, lūk. Un tā viena lieta ir par pacietību. Margrēta Olsthorn ir Eiropā faktiski zināma modes eksperta. Viņai pieder fantastisks veikals Rotterdamā, veikals, no kura kā Baumo ir cēlušies daudz, nu jau pazīstami zīmoli. Un kad es radīju vienu no pirmajām kolekcijām, tad es nolēmu aizsūtīt viņai katalogu, uz kuru viņa atbildēja: "Paldies, I'm not in love with this collection." Pagāja pusgads, es viņai aizsūtīju nākamo kolekciju. Pagāja vēl pusgads, es viņai aizsūtīju atkal kolekciju. Un tad mēs satikāmies un, lūk, mani apavi viņas veikalas katalogā. Un tad tas stāsts par to, ka tām nejaušībām ir baigi jāpalīdz piepildīties tādā ziņā, ka mēģināt izdarīt vēl kaut ko nedaudz vairāk, nekā liekas jau, ka te ir tā robeža, bet tā kā vēl kaut ko. Šī gada sākumā es devos pirmo reizi uz Ņujorku, un par tik, cik man tas bija ļoti liels notikums, tad es, protams, sagatavoju sarakstu ar cilvēkiem no modas industrijas, kurus man ļoti gribētos satikt vai kaut kādā veidā izveidot sadarbību ar viņiem. Adams Katzindings ir fotogrāfs, modes fotogrāfs, bet galvenā lieta viņam pieder šis te unikālais fotografēšanas paņēmiens, un viņa Instagram kontam seko vairāk nekā 370 tūkstoši sekotāji, un viņš ir tāds, nu, faktiski zināma persona modes aprindās. Es devos uz Ņujorku un, nu jā, izrādījās, ka kāds tomēr paziņu lokā viņu pazīst, mēs sarakstījāmies, bet, diemžēl, viņš tajā brīdī bija Kievas modes nedēļā. Bet paiet divas nedēļas un es saņemu no viņa e-pastu, kad, Klau, zini, vispār es vēlos apceļot Eiropu un es vēlos pabūt tādās pilsētās, nu tādās jocīgās kaut kādās, kur es neesmu bijis, un kāpēc gan tā nebūtu Rīga? Lūk, un te mēs esam uz Mākslas akadēmijas jumta un fotografējam manu pavasar-vasaras kolekciju. Un tad tā pēdējā atziņa par to, kad par to reakcijas ātrumu, par to, kad īstenībā citreiz ir ļoti svarīgi sajust, ka nu, šito zvanu tiešām vajag pacelt vai šito e-pastu vajag obligāti atbildēt. Nu, tā kā tūlīt reaģēt. Parīzes modes nedēļā es iepazinos ar kanādiešu dizaineru Michael Thomas Balintu, un mēs tā kā uzreiz sapratām, ka mums ir kaut kādas tādas vecas radnieciskas dvēseles. Un Michaels saka, Klau, brauc pie manis uz Kanādu, uz Toronto modes nedēļu, piedalies ar mani kopā skatē. Un neskatoties uz to, ka tas tā kā bija ieplānots pēc pusotra mēneša, un es nezināju, vai man būs finanses, lai dotos, vai laiks ražošanas plānā, lai vispār saražotu skatēju nepieciešamos apavus. Es tūlīt teicu jā, un, nu, un jā, mēs to izdarījām, un nu, tā kā pēc pusotra mēneša es nokļūtu Toronto ar lielu čemodānu ar apaviem, kur man uz muitas jautāja par to, ko tad es tur vedu. Un tur vienkārši tikai kaut kādi 23 kg ar 43. Līdz 46. Vīriešu apavi. Ir sestdiena, pavasaris, un tāda rāma, mierīga diena, un pie manis ir ciemos atelē ienākuši divi ļoti īpaši viesi. Didrie Grumbachs ir Parīzes augstās modas palātas direktors, Savukārt, Farid Šenons ir vīriešu luksus modes eksperts. Un kamēr šie kungi ap divi iztaujā par to, kā man attīstās biznes un ko es, kā es redzu to savu dizainu vīzijas attīstību, viņi laiko apaus un koķetē viens ar otru, nu vai tad mēs varētu abi vienādas kurpes pirkt un vai tad jau nebūtu nekas pretī. Rezultātā viņi abi nopērk tās kurpes vienādas, viņi abi palūdz tās vecās kurpes iesaiņot un aiziet par Rīgas ielām jaunajās kurpēs uz Parīzes, uz Francijas kultūras centru. Un tādēļ es domāju, ka ir ļoti svarīgi šajā tādā ilgtspējīgas lēnas attīstības procesā sastapt tādus, nu, iedrošinošas patiesībā brīžus, nu, tad tā kā, lai varētu pa to ceļu soļot tālāk tā pacietīgi, pārdomāti, bet droši. Paldies par uzmanību un paldies investīciju aģentūrai par iespēju.
Paldies,
Alīna. Paldies.
Cik vērtīgs ir lēni izjust izstāstīts emocionāls stāsts, vai ne? Juri, atvaino, ka tev būs drusku mazāk laika tagad. Juris Griķis, nakts mēbeles marks M, īsnībā ražotājs, arī radoša personība, bet, lai neatņemt laiku, stāsti nu pats lūdzu.
Sveiki, visi guļam laikam,
jā. Bet tu esi pa vidu, mēs nu starp pusdienām un mums.
Jā, jā, es tā. Ātri nekavēšu, cenšot. Es neesmu nekāds dizaina eksperts, padējuši godīgi, es esmu tāds ražotājs, kurš ikdienu pavada starp ražošanu un starp dizainu un visām tam lietām. Bet es padalīšos kādas manas debesis par šiem 25 gadiem, kurus es aizgājis manā profesionālā karjerā. Nu, manas debesis, laikam, jūs saprotat, ka tā ir gulta tagad, jā. Tās ir debesis, tās ir mans jaunā produkta līnija, Heavens, tāpēc arī es tā saku, debesis mans. Bet īstenībā es visiem stāstu tādas elementāras lietas, un elementāras lietas ir tādas, kur ir dizains. Vispirms radās kaut kāda vienkārša, vienkārši produkts, tad tam vienkāršam produktam piešķīra kaut kādu dizainu, un tad tam dizainu nosauca vārdā. Ja, un tas ir tas tātad produkts, dizains un brandings. Nedaudz es pieskaršos par šiem 25 gadiem, centīšos ātri, bet kāda man pieredze šajā te produktā un brandingā. Jā, Steve Jobs, visu cieņu, man ir telefons pēdējais, bet tas tomēr ir viņi brauc uz to, Apple brauc uz to brandingu, kas jau ir, produktu nav jauna, bet ir brenda lielais kuģis, kur viņi sēž virsū, un viņus pirks gāzīs apkārt. Alvaro Alto, tas es salīdzinu, viņi tā kā Jāni Raini, ja, viņi strādā apmēram taisa pašos laikos, un tas ir, tikai viņš strādāja dizainā un pacēl šo te somu dizainu atpazīstamu. Faktiski tas ir viens no viņa darbiem. Varbūt jūs ziniet šo te dizaineru noteikti, kas studējuši dizainu, tie zin, un viņš tika aizniec ministru kabinetam, bet ne jau šis pa 136 eiro, bet aiznies šo te pa 6 lati. Tas vēl vecajā naudā. Īstenībā jūs varat paskatīties. Šim te brands, šim nosaukums nekāds ir. Viņš maksā 10 eiro. Šis nosaukums, tas ir Alvaro Aalto stūl numur 60 Arteka ražots. Visu cieņu. Man pirmā kompānija, ko es nosaucu, tas bija Ozols, jo katra latviešu kompānija bija jānosauc Ozols. Tas bija tūkstoši.
Man badīja.
Jā. Viss kārtībā, Andrija, jā. Bet mēs ražojam tādu pievienoto vērtību diezgan augstai laikā, 90. Gadu. Tas bija 90. Gads, 91. 92. Tāds mēbelītes kabineta iekārtas, tāds glaunas, arī mīkstās mēbeles ražojam. Un sūtījām daudz uz Krieviju. Un tad nāca laika, kad Krievijas tirgus taisnājās cietu, mēs sākām ražot tādus, kā nu, mazāk tā pievienotā vērtība. Ja es redzēju, tad skapi, salīdzinot ar tur Intarsiju, šeit bija pavirsu, un tāda interesanta krēsla, bet šeit tas bija priedes skaps, jo tur vienkārši bija jāpārdod kaut ko, un pārdevām uz Vāciju. Strādājām uz Vāciju, krāvām fūras, kā saka mēbeļnieki, krāvām fūras. Nu, un beigās vācieši dejoja, mums sausais atlikums praktiski nebija nekāds, un Ozola nācās aizlaist pa kāju, kā saka, atvaino Andriju, neteiksim, bet tad mēs, man no 300 cilvēkiem palika 20 cilvēki kompanija, un sākām domāt par dizainu, pielikām tai priedītei kaut ko klāt, un te jau tādas mēbeles, un tad radās arī nakts mēbeles, ar jau pievienoto vērtību, un patreiz nakts mēbelēm ir 4 saloni, 3 Rīgā, 1 Viļņā, un Pils Madrač man teica, mēbeļa kvalitāte aizvien pieaug, un tie, kas piegādāja man Madrača, teica, es viņiem lūdzu uztaisiet labākus Madračus, man cilvēki prasīja, un viņi teica, znaši, ja es dzielat, ja magu ģešēvļa lučiņi magu, un tad mēs nolēmām paši taisīt, un tad radās Pils Madrač, un Pils Madrač tā arī īstenībā beidzās, jo vēl jau viņi iet, ja, bet tas brenda attīstība paliek tikai Latvijā, jo tas neiet ārpusē, es nevaru rādīt Pils Madrač, jo Pils tas ir alus, tā man viens soms pateica, novāc no savu brenda nosaukumu Pils nost, ja, jo tas ir alus, ja es nevaru teikt, alus Madrač tu tirgo, ja. Tas neiet. Nu, paņēm nost, ja kaut arī Madrač ir labi, radās arī, turpat arī mīkstās gultas un skaists un arvien labāks, bet tad nāca Heavens līnija. Heavens, to, ko man šis tā tirgus izstūma ārā, viņi teica, nu, nosauc kaut kādu Angels Collection, bet man radās Heavens, un tas arī labi. Heavens patreiz ražo, tas ir liels roku darbs un ļoti, ļoti cītīgs, kā saka, mēs ļoti pūlamies, lai cilvēkam būtu aizvien labā gulēšanas šīs tā 8 stundas, ko mēs gribam vai negribam pavadam uz tā Madrač. Un tā, tas ar mums gala produkti jau nāk. Mēbeļnieki, kā likums, mēbeļniekiem eksistē, nu, patreiz mēs tā apzināmies, 3 lielas meses, tas ir Stokholms mēbeļa mesa, Milāns mēbeļa mesa un IMM Ķelnes mēbeļa mesa. Te mēs esam pagājušā mēbeļa mesē ar savām mēbelēm. Mums gāja labi, mēs parādījāmies, bet faktiski iepirkuma nebija arī tāda. Un viņi teica skaidru un gaiši, jūs būsiet šai vietā vēl 2 gadus, tam mēs jums runāsim. Jā, ļoti labi, jo tādas luksus un dizaina lietas no mums negaida. No mums gaida lētas lietas un daudz, jā, līdz kamēr mēs aizējam attiecīgi no šī tirgus ārā. Bet pat cik es esmu koka inženieris pats, un sastāvotāju koka ražotāju asociācija arī mums, un es parādīšu dažu statistiku, kas patreiz ir, un kuri reālā tieks nodarbojas ar koklietu dizainu, kur reālais potenciāls ir. Patreiz mēs šeit ir parādīts mūsu eksports Latvijā pēc stāvokļus 10 mēnešiem, kurināmais apaļkoku zāģmateriāls saplāksnes mēbeles, un tas ir 30 eiro kubikmetrā, tā ir cena, ko mēs maksājam par to, tu nav pierakstīts, atvainojas, redz, kur ir 50, apaļkoku zāģmateriāls saplāksnes, nu mēbeles apmēram tā arī maksā 1250 eiro par kubikmetru mēbeles, tā. Bet šī kopējā bilance 9 mēnešos mēs kaut kur 1,3 miljārdi mūsu koksnes eksportējam. 1,3 miljārdi. Un rekrutāts nedaudz sarežģītāk, tas schēmiņi būtu. Un visvairāk mēs eksportējam zāģmateriālus. Zāģmateriālus mēs eksportējam ar 421 miljonu eiro praktiski. Ja, un mēbeles, mēs tās, kam vislielākā pievienotā vērtība, tā mēbeles mēs eksportējam gandrīz vismazāk. Tas acīm redzam, mēs patreiz eksportējam lietas, produkts ar nelielu pievienotā vērtību. Un praktiski pēc vienkārši aprēķina, ja šos te zāģmateriālus, ko mēs eksportējam kā dēļus, kā dažādas latas, apstrādātu, pārstrādātu mēbelēs, mēs varētu iegūt pavisam vienkārši 782 miljonu eiro nacionālu ienākumu. Praktiski tas ir mūsu rokās, tas ir jūsu rokās īstenībā, arī manās daļē, ja, mīši tavās. Mēs to varam izdarīt, bet tikai varbūt šis stāsts izejot ļoti ātri cauri vienkārši starp sarežģītāku mēbeli, vienkāršāku mēbeli un atkal skaistu mēbeli. Šis ir stāsts par pievienoto vērtību, šis stāsts par dizainu, šis stāsts par mums, par latviešiem, kas spēj. Paldies par uzmanību.
Paldies. Paldies Jurim Griķikungam. Viņš izdarīja labāko kopsavilkumu, kādēļ mēs vispār runājām par dizainu un par vērtības pievienošanu ar uzskatām, piemēram, no kokrūpniecības dzīves. Jums ir, tā kā mēs tiešām tūlīt visi dosimies ēst, un cerams, ka mūsu kolēģi un konkurenti šobrīd no citiem paneļiem nav apēduši visu mūsu maltīti, Tad vieta ir, jeb laiks, burtiski diviem, varbūt trim jautājumiem mūsu diskusijas dalībniekiem. Ja jūs esat tik izsalkuši un negribat neko jautāt, jums būs arī iespēja vienu roku stiepjāst, lūdzu. Jā, strādā. Nestrādā, es atvainojos. Tūkiem, tāpēc tas ir vajadzīgs. Paldies jums, lūdzu. No. Iedodiet varu citu mikrofonu, jo šis tiešām mēs tevi varam.
Agri sauc.
Jā.
Man jautājums tāds, kādas jaunatklājumi un tehnoloģiskās inovācijas virza tagad mēbeļu dizainu uz priekšu?
Kam jūs jautājat šo jautājumu? Visiem, jā?
Nu, tiem, kas ar mēbelēm.
Tu tad ar apaviem nekvalificējās, es sapratu.
Jā.
Piedodēlīgi.
Don't ask me, I don't work with furniture.
3D printer?
Yeah.
Who has courage and most important knowledge?
Nu, praktiski tā, nu, vislielākās pasaules mēsis jau rāda tās tendences, kuras mēs apmeklējam regulāri. Un praktiski Aldis pārstāv vienu no tām tendencēm, tas ir liek līmētais mēbeles, tas ir, kas varētu būt ļoti, ļoti populārs. Tad pasaulē nāk tagad tas daba iekšā, nāk daba, nāk tā saucamā natural green, vēl vien bija trīs lietas, kā nosauc to. Nāk tā saucamē wildwood iekšā, tas ir koki ar atstātām vainām iekšā, respektīvi, ja mēbeļniekiem man skolā mācīja, kad zari ir jāizklasē un jāgriež ārā, tad tagad mēbelēs vairāk tiek lietot šie zari iekšā, tas ir masīvu koku mēbelēs, krēslos, nē.
Aldi ir kas papildinās?
Jā. Diemžēl liek līmētās aplākšņi ražošanā sevišķi lielas inovācijas pēdējās desmitgadēs nav veikts, bet mēbeļu industrijā kopumā tas, kas šobrīd diezgan strauji attīstās, ir 3D printēšana. Tāpat kā starp citu visās citās nozarēs mašīnu būvē un es nezinu, tur plastmasas rūpniecībā un tam līdzīgi. Tad oktobra beigās Ķelnē notika lielākā biroja mēbeļa izstāde Orgatek. Katru otro gadu tāda notiek. Un jau sērija veidā šogad tika demonstrētas vairākam vācu firmām, tātad dažādi, teiksim, nu, sēdmēbeles, ķeblīšu, taburetes un tam līdzīgas lietas, kas bija vienkārši noprintētas.
Varbūt nu, tiem kolēģiem šeit ir uzņēmējiem, kas nesaprot 3D printēšanu tādās detaļās, tagad ir attīstītas modernas tehnoloģijas, kur iekārtas pa slānītim līmē vai nu no plasmas, visizplatītākie ir tieši plasmas, trīsdimensionālie printeri, ka faktiski ar datoru modelēta trīsdimensionāla vienība tiek uzražot individuālā skaitā, un to dara programmējums darba galds šis trīsdimensionāls printeris.
Jā, Andri, bet vienīgi tas ir, Aldi, visi kārtībā 3D var uztaisīt, bet mums jāpārdod ir mūsu nacionāla bagātība. Mūsu nacionāla bagātība ir mūsu roku darbs, mūsu koks šeit, kas ir, tie ir mūsu resursi. Ja.
Un radošumu.
Un radošumu, tieši tā, tas mums jāpārdod. Un ja tā, teiksim, par koku var teikt, ka tas Wildwood nāk, rulē faktiski, printēšana, var, jā, plasmasās.
Arī Wildwood drīz varēs nopredēt, nebēdēt.
Izvērsās garš jautājums.
Mīkstajās mēbelēs, tapsētās mēbelēs, atkal tādu materiālu kā poliuretānu vietā, ko jūs saucat par poroloniem un gumijām, nāk īsta vilna, nāk īstas dūnas, nāk īsti lini, nāk iekšā tādas lietas. Tās lietas, tām lietām var pievienot, tā vislielākā pievienotā vērtība.
Tas paldies, Jūri. Vēl Henrikam ir papildinājums.
Yeah, I think it was very evident when you looked at what was in the Milan Furniture Fair this year, and you looked at the big kitchen companies, which I obviously then looked a lot at, the Arclineas and Scavolini and all of them. They were actually showing a lot of interiors with untreated wood surfaces, with a natural texture.
Like raw wood.
Yeah, the raw wood. Yeah. But executed with an exquisite finish, so there would be no visible screws, there would be fantastically finely done joints, and this sort of, the craftsmanship was absolutely immaculate. But they dared to let the material be honest, let the material be what it was. And then, of course, they used technologies like laser cutting to get all the pieces to the absolute perfection. But they still allowed wood to be wood and not mimicking anything else, which I think is a very typical trend also when you look at a lot of interiors right now. You're getting a lot of unpainted wood. So there's more the natural colors of the wood and you've got the little branches.
Or like unpainted, but yeah, it's treated, yeah.
Painted, but like unpainted.
Yeah. Yes.
And the funny thing is that my previous industry, the car industry, they are actually now, when I worked with cars, you had to put like 8 or 10 layers of varnish on the wood so it would last the duration of the lifetime of the car. What's happened there is that it looked like plastic. So you could do a 3D print on the back instead because nobody would be able to judge whether it was real wood or not. What you see now in luxury cars is that it actually has the grain. Yes. So they treat it in a different way to be able to show that this is actually a natural material with a really nice natural finish because the tactile experience is so important when you touch a product.
Thank you. Thank you for good remarks. Nu, es saku visiem vēl pēdējais jautājums, Gunts Učelnieks lūdzu.
Latviski, lai visi saprotat, tā kā dizains un inovācijas ir ļoti svarīgi sastāvdaļa jebkurā biznesā, tad varbūt viens vai divi ieteikumi no katra paneļa dalībnieka šeit klātesošiem, kas ir bijuši svarīgi viņiem dzīvē un nodarījuši vai palīdzējuši. Viens vai divi ieteikumi.
So, Henrik, let us start again with you.
Okay.
You have no time to think about just...
No, I won't spend a lot of time to think about it. I think the number one thing is stay true to yourself, which means don't try to be anybody else from a design point of view. Don't try to make what you think people would like or would choose, because you're going to get so disappointed when they don't choose your design. So at least you should be happy with what you do. And I think the other thing is that if your aim is to make money, you're thinking the wrong way. Your aim should be doing what you feel is the right thing to do. And if you do that successfully, the consequence is that you will make money. I never tried to make a career. I always was happy with being just a designer, and I ended up in a place where I thought, like, if somebody would have told me 25 years where I was going, I would probably looked at them and either said that they lied or I would be terrified and chosen a different profession.
Thank you. Paulius. Mr. Nielsen.
Yeah, I would like to say two things. The first one is really, really short, and that's a response to the question. And I think that the speaker number two on the seminar before us, your friend?
Yeah, Steve.
Steve? He said absolutely everything that I agree on. I think that also don't make money. Also, Henrik is also touching
100%,
on. 100%. Yes. Yeah, don't make money. No one's going to make money. Then if you want to make money, you're in the wrong industry.
Well, you sorry can, to say. Then you misunderstand me, because what I'm saying is don't focus on making money.
No, but I think you should pay rent. Yeah, you should pay rent.
You still need to make money, but don't make that your goal.
Don't try to get rid. And the last thing I want to say, because we talked about the challenges for the industry and talk about trends, I think that one of the major trends is, of course, I see two things that's going to happen, and it has to do with retail. One is, of course, the threat of China. Today, we all have apps in our phones. Today, I can order a sweatshirt from China and have it delivered to my door for, what is it, 2 euros? 2 euros. Who can compete with that as a full sweater? Yeah. And that's on in my iPhone and have it delivered to my door, including in the price. Who can compete with that? No one can compete with that. So that's going to happen more. And then, of course, we have IKEA and all the other ones. And what I think is more, of course, is what Elina's brand is, what Elina's world is doing. I think that the local small production is happening. That's where the future is. Stay true, stay local, you know, use technology. But local, small, unique objects, that's what we're looking for, as complementing to the 2 euro sweater.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Strong statement.
Yeah, I know. That's my thing. For fuck's sake, come on.
Stefan, just a short comment. Actually, what Steve Kale was saying fits even more and is more appropriate to Latvian backbone economy, which are small and medium-sized companies. Because if you're a large-scale company, you cannot really think in such a categories. Mm-hmm. But you have this choice, either losing personality, becoming too industrial. Mm-hmm. But for Latvians, as a general recipe, it works extremely well because we are SMEs. And if we see what Elina is doing, and actually all of us here doing, we do not only tailor-made, it sounds even too stereotypical nowadays, but we really love what we do. And then, of course, as a consequence, you do succeed. And if your passion goes to some sector which unfortunately is not rewarded with finances, then you just have a bad luck, but you cannot make more money just doing what you do not like in your life. So.
But Elina is the future. That's what I'm trying to say. Elina is the future. That's the way she's working is the future.
Exactly. Before I give the floor to Aldis, I must announce that there will be no food, you know. bad news, but we have good news as well.
Just stay another hour in here because there's no food for you anyway.
No food. No?
Okay. You get slim for Christmas. Perfectly.
Exactly. Just perfect. And another news is we can wrap it up because with this panel, our business forum ends up, so we have a bit more time. Thank you.
Grūti spriest, kurš šajā auditorijā no padomiem būtu visvajadzīgākais, bet jebkurā gadījumā tie, kuri domā vai mēģina atrast savu taciņu, kas ir jau kādā saistībā ar dizainu, tad es gribētu ieteikt, nu, teiksim, divas lietas arī. Pirmkārt, nebaidīties arī no sevis tā skaitā. Un pārliecību pasniegt savas idejas un produktus. Un otrs būtu neiepriecinošs, teiksim, konstatējums, ka, lai to izdarītu, tad nav darba laika. Respektīvi, nevar nofiksēt darba laika, jums ir jādomā par to, ko jūs dariet 24 stundas dienā, 7 dienas nedēļā. Un tas ir tas nepatīkamākais.
Arī sēžot un guļot, jo mēs
pavadām. Tā ir skaitā, sēžot, guļot visu laiku. Nu, pēc kāda laika jūs atrodat sevi, teiksim, diezgan lielā izmisumā, konstatējot, ka
Vēlas, es taču ne par ko citu vairs neesmu domājis, teiksim tā, vai ne pēdējos trīs mēnešus.
Bet tā kā semināra mērķis bija zināms iedrošinājums, man viens komentārs ir šajā sakarā. Jo tā kā mēs reiz novadījām jauniešiem iedrošinošu semināru, kāpēc nodarboties ar uzņēmējdarbību, nevis iet pieteikties darbā, tad nu, gan Lauris Liberts draugiem LV, gan stendznieks toreiz, gan arī stender ražotāji, ziepju un kosmetikas ražotāji, izcēla otru to jauku aspektu, ka tomēr, ka tu pats esi sev saimnieks un arī savam laikam tādā izpratnē, ka, kad ieplānot atvaļinājumu un kad nav jāprasa citiem, kura nav, kurā cīm redot, dažiem nav. Bet,
nu, vislabāk atvaļinājumu ir neieplānot. Ja, tas ir pirmais, kas baigi palīdz biznesam.
Nu, tā man neļaus neko pozitīvu pateikt.
Nē, pagaidi. Ja. Pašās beigās man ir ķirsīts, vai ne, uz kūks. Tāpēc, kad visus tos, teiksim, tos trūkums, ko jūs neglābjami tajā ceļā, nu, tā kā izjūtiet un iegūstiet, beigās atsver tas gandarījums par to, ka kaut kas sanāk. Tā sajūta īstenībā ir
tā vērta.
Nu, miljonus kilogramu smaga. Katrā ziņā tas ceļojums, es nezinu, uz Taizemi, tur es nezinu, uz Karībām, viņš aizmirsīsiet pēc diviem gadiem, jūs nevarat pateikt, vēl kā to pilsētu sauc, kur bija tie lielie ziloņi. Ne? Nu, tā, bet viss to, ko jūs būsiet izdarījuši sev, es nezinu, savai ģimenei vai vienalga, nu, patētiski savai valstī, vai ne, tas gala beigās, nu, sajūta ir ļoti patīkama.
Liels paldies. Elīna.
Nu jā, īstenībā es vienu tādu lietu gribēju pastāstīt, ka mēs jau kā dizaineri visi esam arī diezgan jūtīgi savā, nu, tādā stāvoklī, un ir ļoti krāsi šie te augšā un lejā periodi, un ir brīži, kad tu esi ļoti augšā un tev viss ļoti patīk, bet ir jau arī tie, nu, lejas punkti. Kad tu saproti, ka tev ir šis te mazais it kā ilgtspējīgais uzņēmums, bet tu esi aptuveni viena cilvēka orķestrs un tev vienkārši nepietiek stundas. Un tad man recepte, ko es esmu atradusi, kas man ļoti strādā un palīdz, man ir tāda ļoti tuvu draugu komanda, varētu teikt, kad es zinu, šim draugam es zvanīšu tajā brīdī, kad man kaut kas iet ar finansēm galā, šim draugam es zvanīšu tad, kad atkal man ir vienkārši kaut kāds tur iestājies un nu, tādā ziņā, kad, nu, jo, nu, par to, kad ir tie viļņi, kad nav jau viss tikai tā, kad, nu, tagad, cik forši viss un tā, nu, kad...
Tas pirmais tas draugs ir baņķieris, ne?
visi draugi.
Nē, exakt.
Labi, paldies.
Jūris Grīts. Pēdējais, vai? Jaunajiem es neko gudrāk par Steve Jobs, Stay Foolish, Stay Hungry nevaru pateikt, bet jau pieredzējušāk cilvēkiem, jau kā man, nu neviens ieteikums, bet es sākšu ar nelielu pastāstu, kad tikko atnāca maniem vienu arhitektu ar ļoti perfektu bukletu, viņi piedāvāja lampas taisīt man. Piedāvāja savas lampas pārdot. Un tas buklets ļoti skaists bija, bet tās lampas nekam nederīgs. Es tur parādīju vairākiem saviem, teiksim, iepircējiem un kolēģiem, kas tirgoņi saka, neiet. Bet es paskatījos, tad viņas, ko viņa dara, tā arhitekta savā ikdienas darbā, viņa taisa brīnišķīgas skulptūras. Brīnišķīgas. Es iedomājos, ka es man vajadzēju skapu piemnekli kādu sūtīt, noteikti sūtīšu piņas. Ļoti. Un tāpēc mans ieteikums tādiem cilvēkiem jau pieredzi, tomēr atrast to savu aicinājumu dzīvē un palikt tajā aicinājumā. Atrodiet to aicinājumu un godīgi pret sevis paliekiet. Necensieties kaut ko darīt tādu, kas jūs neesiet. Un tad jums novinnēsiet. Paldies.
Paldies visiem runātājiem. Liels paldies. Thank you very much for your input.
Thank you.